Blackstone Audio presents Alfred Hitchcock and the Making of Psycho by Stephen Rebello. To my family, who keep me honest. Preface. I was originally hired to consult and to give notes on screenplay drafts written by the screenwriter the producers had hired. The producers figured out pretty quickly that I had more to offer and my role expanded. The project circulated around Hollywood and attracted the attention of heavyweights, a number of whom, when it came time to step up to the plate, balked at the prospect of going up against the ghost of Hitchcock. One of the more offbeat, unexpected, and fearless of those directors became attached. What did I want most? To see the making-of aspect serve as backdrop to a tale revolving around the complex personal and professional relationship of Alfred and Alma Hitchcock. I wanted a film that would pull back the curtain on the relationship of two of the most private and gifted collaborators who ever worked in Hollywood. I also wanted it to be fun, stylish, witty, a love story with a butcher knife hanging over it, if you will. In the succeeding 4 years, our project found homes at several studios, was given two separate green light start dates, got derailed by a contentious Writers Guild of America strike, and lost its original director. From then on, once again, Hitchcock again got courted by and rejected by directors of both the household name and up-and-coming varieties. Through the Sturm und Drang, I was always grateful and never doubted that the movie would get made. And now here we all sit in this 20th Century Fox conference room, listening to a scene in which Helen Mirren's loving, strong, charming, bracingly intelligent Alma fires off some home truths to Anthony Hopkins' loving, obsessive, pressured Alfred. The actors clash with such craft, art, intensity, and vividness that I sense many in the room wanting to applaud. The moment is even sweeter for me because it has always been one of my favorite moments in the screenplay. Now these spectacular actors take and run with it, make it their own. That adrenaline rush happens again and again, not only when Sir Anthony and Dame Helen work their magic, but also when Michael Wincott makes murderer Ed Gein as oddly sympathetic as he is blood-curdling, and when Richard Portnow, as the fearsome, powerful head of Paramount Pictures, goes head-to-head with Sir Anthony's equally fearsome, intransigent Hitchcock. Bells also go off when both Jessica Biel and James Darcy prove to be so touching in their scenes with Sir Anthony that they bring tears to the eyes of even a couple of industry veterans. The barbed dialogue and the jokes get laughs, intended laughs, excitement, release, and, okay, a little euphoria. The table read ends in sustained applause, congratulations, sniffles, guarded optimism, and excited anticipation about the challenges ahead. Sheer adrenaline alone could have propelled me all the way home, but I took the conventional method and drove my car off the Fox lot, thinking how far Alfred Hitchcock and the Making of Psycho has traveled since its publication 22 years ago after dozens of publishing houses had turned it down. Thanks to my then-agent, the late Julian Bach, elegant, boundlessly energetic, justifiably legendary, and the late S. Arthur Red Demner, a straight-shooting former Newsweek executive turned independent book publisher, the book got published, although modestly and without fanfare. But our audience found us, especially after May 9, 1990, when the New York Times published Christopher Lehman Haupt's favorable review on the front page of its Books of the Times section. To commemorate the 30th anniversary of the theatrical release of Psycho, I was soon invited as a guest on several national and international TV shows, and the book became a college course curriculum staple. To this day, not a week goes by without at very least one person contacting me with a question or a comment about the book. And if my current literary agent, the wise, ferociously supportive, and indefatigable Mary Evans, hadn't spurred the book's reissue, producers Alan Barnett and Tom Thayer might never have found it. All these years later, I still want to tinker with the text, clarify the chronology, fix glitches, and describe how my reactions to Psycho have shifted over time. I considered the film a brilliant thrill ride and con game, but now see it as far more. However, it is always gratifying to learn that so many readers, and some critics anyway, appreciate that I deliberately chose not to analyze, dissect, deconstruct, or, especially, wring the life out of Psycho. Instead, I wanted to dig up the facts, dispel the rumors, and engage as many of the people responsible for the film as I could, while we were still lucky enough to have them around to share their recollections. 22 years after the book's first publication, it was an immensely powerful, moving, and sometimes meta experience to watch the director, cast, and crew of Hitchcock recreate certain real-life aspects of the book, melded with images, dialogue, scenes, and sequences from the script. "Wait," I sometimes wanted to say, "that isn't what he or she looked like or wore. That isn't what they said or how they sounded saying it." At other moments, everything felt eerily, precisely right, especially when the gifted movie makers reinterpreted in almost documentary fashion the making and release of Psycho itself. Let me share some favorite on-set moments, spoiler-free, I hope. Some of the best of these unfolded on the lot and on sound stages at Hollywood's historic Red Studios, opened in 1915 as Metro Pictures Backlot No. 3, later owned by Desi Arnaz and Lucille Ball, and renamed Desilu Studios and still later called Renmar Studios. It was a filming site for such TV shows and films as I Love Lucy, The Dick Van Dyke Show, The Andy Griffith Show, The Jack Benny Program, I Spy, The Golden Girls, Seinfeld, Weeds, and Who Framed Roger Rabbit. I eyewitnessed the shooting of some satisfying moments, like a scene with Sir Anthony as Hitchcock and the brilliant Toni Collette playing longtime Hitchcock production assistant Peggy Robertson. They sit together in canvas chairs on the Psycho set and, meticulously shot by great cinematographer Jeff Cronenweth, we see them big and bold in the foreground, with their backs to us. Meanwhile, in the background, fiercely independent beauty Vera Miles, played by Jessica Biel, gets ushered onto the set and into her dressing room to begin her first day of shooting. Biel's movements, even the tilt of her head, subtly inform us about Miles' bloodied but unbowed attitude toward having fallen out of favor with her would-be Svengali, Hitchcock. Sir Anthony regales Colette with choice, snide observations, some script.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.